monthly accidents handle all the games. But at the end, an Egyptian like Nour Shebini, Shebiti, so I'm glad that we took the title again.
At the end, it was still with an Egyptian.
Yes.
But what about your wins? Do you feel that it has added to your record so
far? I only play junior tournaments. I only play two junior tournaments per year, mm-hmm. the Junior Open and the World Junior Open on the 19th. And all my other tournaments are based on women's. It's called WISPA, WISPA International Squash Association. So I usually travel a lot every year to play WISPA. So this is one of the in my life, and I wanted to win the title. But then I played in the semi-final and an English girl called Emily Whitlock, and she's number one in England. And she was seeded number two, so she was the one expected to go to the semi-finals, not me. And so I was happy to beat her in her country. And I lost to her in this same tournament. So I was very happy to beat her again in her court, in her country, and in something that she was, in the match that she was expected to win.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Kansi, with this performance so far and this great win, do you believe that there is hope for you girls to reach the women squash championships worldwide and hopefully get great achievements like the guys did?
Yes, of course. Like we've been this year, actually, I was in the national team. I was number three in it, and we under 19s, and we won the title. So I think we won the title twice. I played the with the team twice, and we won first place twice. So I think that we, as four Egyptian, the first four Egyptian girls on the 19th in Egypt, we're much better than any. And I think that in the future, we're the most powered team through the whole country.
We should hope that. Although we have seen how squash brought great trophies to Egypt, indeed. It is still perceived as not such a very familiar or maybe popular game to Egypt. It hasn't spread throughout other governorates. Why do you think is that the case?
Really, we've been doing meetings, everything to, and we've been trying to, they've been trying to put the discussion to the Olympics for the past 5 years, but they can't do it. I don't know why, but some people think that it's not. It shouldn't be in the Olympics, and in the final decision, they said that it might. It has a percentage that it might be in the Olympics of 2016, and I really hope so, because for me, I would rather win one good Olympic title than maybe six other normal title of normal big tournaments. So yeah, and it's also very sad that. Very, very famous squash players like Amr Shabana or Karim Darwish, or a lot of Egyptian players, Omneya, Inji, all of them. They work so hard that people never understand, and they're not known in Egypt, and they're very known in the squash community and everything, but they're not known as the
soccer player.
Yeah, or like anyone. Mm. Yeah.
But I guess we're trying to give them. You guys and girls, your definite weight, because maybe the squash is one of the very few sports that definitely brought the name of Egypt high on the international agenda. Like in this British Junior Championship, most of the winners and those seeded high in the ranking are Egyptians.
Egyptian, yeah.
How did it feel? Tell me about that. Not on the personal experience, on the Egyptian level.
Well, first of all, everyone was surprised that the huge number of us Egyptians who were going to this tournament. Mm. The English Federation, they actually limited the number of the Egyptians because they were scared, and they said that we could only send that the Egyptian Federation can only send five players in each age group. So that's why we were only 60 players. So all the other countries were like maybe 20, between like 30 maximum, and we were the only one who were 60.
And you were at the end competing against each other.
Yeah, like in the under 19s, the first three girls were Egyptians. In the boys under 19s, the first four guys were Egyptians. We took at the end like maybe, 12 or 13 titles, trophies at the end. So everyone was very surprised, actually.
Indeed, but we're very proud. Okay, Kanzi, I want to ask you about squash as a game here in Egypt. Not on the international scale, like in the Olympics that you've explained. Why do you think it's still not yet popular?
Well, it's a bit popular in Egypt. It's getting more and more popular every day. And I think that it's actually popular in Egypt. Like, if you go in any Egyptian club, in all the clubs in Egypt, you find squash courts, and some people playing squash. But it has, it's definitely the percentage of popularity is definitely disappointing. Like, we do so much effort, all of us squash players do so much effort that no one sees that, no one understands what to do.
Mm-hmm. A lot of people have said that the great achievement that has been made at the British Squash Championship, the Open Squash Championship in 2012, reflects the great effort that was exerted by you guys, of course, and girls, and also the coach, Anir Wagi. Tell me about his recommendations, his style in coaching.
Well, first of all of the Egyptians were training very hard to beat. They were playing all the tournaments of the season. We have 12 tournaments in the year. So they were competing in all the tournaments to be able to be from the first five players, be able to go. To be able to go to tournaments. And after we went there, Amir Aguirre is a very good coach. He was the head coach of our team. We went 3 days earlier, and he was coaching us very well, actually. And he put limits. Like, for example, if two Egyptians were playing each other, he set up a rule that no coaches were able to coach each other to coach their players or anything. For them to be equal.
Mm-hmm. Great. Well, Kanzi Dafraoui, the second runner-up at the 2012. Thank you very much, and congratulations once again. Thank you very much. We'll go for a quick break, and we'll be back for more on Nile Cruise.
يا حبيبي ده انت لحقتني وقلبي اللي كان بيموت عليك دلوقتي عاش
سقيت الصاوي organized a one-of-a-kind celebration which featured a host of former Star Academy stars who succeeded in recent years.
بالراحة طب والهدى والكلام غير ده بقى جيت عليا بصيت عليا
I love singing old songs, not very old songs, but the very modern but old a bit. I love to sing. I had my new song. It was a techno style, and I love all beats of all types of music: techno, pop, hip hop, trance. I would have loved to sing more than this, but there's other people who are singing as well. So if I get a chance to do it alone, I'd do a lot of an extremely big a set of other different songs.
إنه حلو وغنوتين عمر يا بلدي
The actor/singer who made his acting debut last Ramadan in the TV series Al-Shahroura spoke about his future plans and his collaboration with producer Mido Munib.
قلبي مليان بحكايات فاكرة يا بلدي
Mido Munib is an amazing person. I met him through Nasir. I had the song, it was a Turkish song, and I had no idea how the words would fit, the Arabic words to be fit with a Turkish song. So I met Mido Munib. Nasir introduced me to Mido, and it was amazing. The collaboration was amazing because he is a person who really understands what he wants. He listens to music. Vast-minded, so he knows what is and what is not, and so he loved the song, especially that my song. It doesn't age at all because it's a techno style. Techno, everyone likes to hear techno style. So and that was it, and I'm very glad to be in this collaboration, this compilation CD with Mido.
I started singing at the Cairo Opera House. I was taught by Mr. Salim Sahab and Dr. Gamal Salama. Then I took part in Star Academy, where I sang a track written by Usama Mahrez and composed by Haytham Nabil.
يحياها والروح وإيه قالوا كتير اشتقتلي لو بدو عمري كله بعطي
A large number of youth enjoyed the concert and sang along with their favorite artists.
Former Star Academy talent Hania Seyran and Diala were at the Saya for the first time, with huge numbers of Egyptian youth attending. Ahmed Nader Funar Cruz.
And now it's time for the musical segment of this edition of Nile Cruise. We're very pleased to have with us members of the Bahia Band, which is a newly created Egyptian musical band. The band comprises two members who play the oud and also sing. They met during the Occupy Cabinet sit-in, which they used to, where they used to play the songs of Sheikh Said Darwish and Sheikh Imam. Allow me to welcome Abdel Ghani Said. Thank you very much for being with us, and Omar Al-Ayyad.
Hello.
Well, tell us a little bit about the band. Is it that recent?
Yes, it's that recent. We met actually in the first day of the Occupy Cabinet sit-in. I was playing the songs of Sheikh Imam. Then I met him, and he had his oud with him. Then we started playing together. Then we've been in the same tent in the sit-in for the 3 weeks or a month, I think. And we used to play daily the songs of Sheikh Imam and Said Darwish.
Mm-hmm, great. Omar, was it always a dream for you to do such a thing, to play?
Yeah, it was always a dream, but I think after the revolution, it's mainly about a message. It's not about the dream of Omar to be a singer.
Mm-hmm. You want to make us hopefully enjoy one of those messages throughout your song?
Yeah.
Okay, sure. Let's listen.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Shows that it is inspired by what Egypt has been going through, is that correct?
Yeah.
Who wrote the lyrics?
It's for Ahmed Fouad Negm, and the music is for Sheikh Imam.
Uh-huh.
And it talks about the Anarohat al-Ala, it means it talks about one of the most famous prisons. Mm-hmm. It's called the Sijn al-Ala, where most of the politicians of the 70s and the 80s got arrested in this.
Indeed. And why do you felt that there is a need to revive those old songs once again? Do you feel that it's so similar to what today's
Egypt?
Yes,
it's similar to what we are passing by these days,
mm-hmm.
For sure.
And have you thought about maybe changing a little bit the wordings to adapt it to today, or do you feel that it is so much reflective of the past and the present?
Yeah, actually sometimes we do that for in some songs. And some songs are just expressive as they are, and but yeah, in some songs we do change some parts.
Slightly,
yeah, to some parts.
Do you have an example? Have you done that in?
No. Yeah.
Not currently.
Yeah. Yeah.
Not okay. Omar, you've said that you mainly want the. So do you feel that through song and art, this is a good medium?
Yeah, for sure. Because this medium, everybody is interact with this medium. Because it's a good medium to deliver the message through, mm-hmm. I think.
And how is the spirit on the streets of Egypt when there is people gathering under the banner of the revolution, of course, and you go on singing such beautiful songs? Can you describe the mood?
This is actually one of the most good benefits out of this revolution, because before the revolution, I used to play Sheikh Imam and Said Darwish, blah blah. But people were like, oh, who's the Sheikh Imam?
They don't know.
Somehow, I'm very happy because you can find Sheikh Imam somehow a mainstream singer, and we sometimes sing in the streets, like in Kurba or West El Balad, etc. And we find people, random people in the streets, requesting some songs for Sheikh Imam. Mm. So that's one of the benefits of the revolution, that this kind of songs has been revived.
You feel that there is a renaissance once again? Is that how you feel as well, Amma?
Yeah, yeah. Uh-huh. For sure.
And which song do you like the best for?
Really, like Al Bahr Bayt Hakli, it's one of my favorites. Mm-hmm.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Okay, is that what you want to show our audience right now, or do you have any other choices?
Yeah,
okay, go ahead.
Sorry?
ولا لا أشبه البال على الأرض
day.